Today we're honoring 21 years of Video Masters by putting some of the best work our co-hosts have done into one episode. But this time, we're adding a bit of a twist to it. This is Cons, Collectors, and Comics, today on VMTV. I have had the privilege of being graced with some exceptional talent over the last 21 years of this show. From Jason to both Matts, Bree, Stephanie, Rob, Chris, and yes, even Earl the Robot. Everybody brought something fresh and new to the table. And to honor them, we've put together just a few clips from past episodes that feature either a convention, a game collector, or a comic book-based property. Without further ado, let's begin.
Fan film! Superhero fan films. You see them all the time on the internet, and some of them, wait, let me rephrase. Most of them just plain suck. They don't have a budget, they're not taken very seriously, and if they're not taken seriously, they should at least have a tiny bit of irony. Once in a great while, though, there are some that are actually pretty damn good. That includes our entry this month. It's called Batman, Seeds of Arkham, which is actually a follow-up to a short film called Batman, City of Scars. It is done by a gentleman by the name of Aaron Shankey and his cast of characters and really competent crew. This man is a one-man wonder kind, much like his fellow auteur and contemporary Orson Welles. Aaron Shankey directs, he produces, he edits. He does camera work, and he stars in this magnum opus. I think he actually even provided craft service and a travel stipend to his entire cast and crew. And you know what? It's actually not too bad.
What Batman, Seeds of Arkham has going for it mainly is some pretty darn good production value and a sense of gritty realism that Christopher Nolan is currently providing with his blockbuster Batman franchise. It's very likely Nolan was the main influence here in many aspects, and the performances aren't too shabby either. Our filmmaking wonderkind, Aaron Shankey, plays Dick Grayson's alter ego, Nightwing, and he likes to spend at least 6 days a week at the gym and probably watches what he eats. As a scantily clad, uber-hot Poison Ivy, straddles him shirtless, grinding, slashing, and leaking poison into his shredded physique. She's played quite convincingly by Alexa May. This entry may be a bit randy for the kiddies to see, if they haven't already, but I like it too. And there's something for the ladies.
You don't have the power.
Not yet.
As in Batman City of Scars, Batman is once again played by Kevin Porter, emulating a physical manifestation of fellow Batman Kevin Conroy, who does a nicely understated and pretty competent kick-ass job as the Cape Crusader, who doesn't sound like he needs a throat lozenge. He's also got a Tim Burton Batmobile replica in tow and gets called Bat-Bitch. That was amusing to me.
Out the car, Bat-Bitch!
Zango Henry portrays a hugely menacing Killer Croc, a cool character that we have yet to see in the live Batman universe. Some of the fighting could be edited better and the stage combat moves could have been cleaner, but even still, Batman does dispose of the baddies and bleeds for his efforts. On the whole, I think you'll enjoy Batman Seeds of Arkham in the spirit in which it was made, and perhaps you may even hope they continue the series with a bigger budget and some marketing to a larger audience. I'd actually like to see the Bat-Bitch and Poison Nightwing go at it. They certainly put a great deal of hard work, long hours, and chutzpah into this project. It shows, and I give them kudos for the audacious effort. Holy new fashion line of Victoria's Secret supervillainous undergarments, Batman! You may want to give it a watch.
Hey folks, this is Matt Rao of Video Masters TV, and I'm here with Chuck Van Pelt of Recycled Gamer, and we are here at an undisclosed location in Vancouver, Washington, at Rick Weiss's house. Chuck?
Thanks, Matt. Rick Weiss is one of the organizers of the Portland Retro Game Expo, which happens here in Portland on September 20th. And he invited us to come out to his house today to check out his awesome game room. Should we check it out?
Let's go.
All right.
Hello, I'm Matt Rao from Video Masters. You must be Rick.
Yes, I am.
Hi, how are you doing?
Pretty good. Want to come on in?
I'd love to come in. Thank you. So this is the collection. Look at this. This is amazing.
Where's the power glove? I need the power glove.
That's awesome. Look at this. We've got the Wii remote.
We used a Wiimote.
To hold up.
It's these...
The most expensive things in the galaxy.
Cartridges are mocking the Wiimote by saying, this is all that you're good for is to hold up in our display case.
You sound like Darth Vader.
In the back here, look at this cartridge here. I got to show this one off. Mm-hmm. This cartridge right here is a 2600 Air Raid by Menavision, which is... God, probably one of the most rare games ever, and it's got this awesome T-shaped handle on the back.
Mm-hmm.
And if you ever see a cartridge with a handle like that, doesn't mean it's going to be worth a lot of money, but if you have this one, then you may have something.
Cool.
And you should call me right away.
With cash. So, Rick, thanks for inviting us into your house and your game room here. It's really impressive. I'm at a loss for words, almost. How long have you been collecting this stuff?
Over 30 years now.
30 years. That is late 70s, maybe?
It was actually started in about July or January of 1978.
Wow. And have you ever stopped collecting in that time, in those 30 years? Have you dropped off and come back to it?
There was a couple of years I did leave off for about a year and here and there, but always came back to it.
What types of systems and games do you collect here?
Mostly Atari 2600. I do have a few other systems I collect for, but not as hardcore as Atari 2600.
I see. Yeah, I see a lot of Atari logos. I have seen a few other logos, like some Nintendo and an Xbox 360 behind me. Rick, how many games would you say you have in this vast collection here?
For Atari 2600, it's probably about 1,500 total, counting all the other systems. I would say close to 2,000.
2,000 games. Wow, that's amazing. What is, and this is a hard question, what is your favorite item in this room?
Probably be the Atari 2600 kiosk. It would be what you'd find in like a Kmart or a Toys R Us.
Wow, you've got one of those?
Actually, I have two of those.
Two? Oh my gosh, we've got to go look at these things. Rick, I'm going to ask Chuck to come in here because he's got some questions for you too.
Oh, great.
All right, I'll be back.
Hi, Rick. I had a chance to look around your game room here, and it's really amazing. And I was wondering, what is the rarest video game item that you have in the room here?
Probably the Game Brain. It works kind of like a supercharger, but instead of just playing the games, you could actually record it onto cassette tapes.
So is that for the Atari 2600 system?
That's correct.
Oh, that's amazing. So,
and I'm the only collector that I know that has one right now.
Oh, really? So where would one find one of these devices?
Good luck. I know this was in a magazine called The Logical Gamer back in the early 80s, and it was a very not really popular, very low subscription.
So this requires a tape recorder to work. You plug this into the the cassette, and it actually downloads onto a standard audio type cassette.
Correct.
That is really amazing. Thanks for showing it to us.
Oh, no problem.
So, Rick, I understand you're one of the organizers of the Portland Retro Game Expo. Could you tell me a little bit about how that got started?
Well, it got started back in 1997, and that was mostly in Seattle. And about 4 years ago, I moved it to Portland, and that's where it's got a lot more vendors coming in.
Oh, okay. So where is the expo held this year?
Oh, it was the last couple of years it was at the near PDX, but we moved it to the Portland Crown Plaza.
Oh, so that's down by the convention center, isn't it?
Correct.
Okay. How could someone find out more about the Retro Game Expo?
Just go to our website at retrogamingexpo.com.
Oh, fantastic. All right, Matt. So was that awesome or what?
That was the ultimate experience.
Rick's really got an amazing collection, and if you come to the Portland Game Expo, you'll get to meet him. He's a really nice guy, and I want to thank him very much for letting us walk through his house and check out that awesome collection.
Yeah, Chuck, thank you for helping me and Video Masters do this little interview with Rick.
I'm happy to do it.
Yeah, it's awesome. All right, well, we'll see you all later.
Take care.
Bye.
Hey, what's shaking, folks? Now, back at the beginning of Season 3, I posted on the Video Masters TV forums a poll which I would let you guys pick what game I reviewed. And I'm sorry I'm such a lazy ass and I'm just now getting around to it, but I am happy to announce that the winner of the contest is a game whose subject matter I'm very familiar with. Check this out. Alright, now I'm ready. Let's review the fucking Punisher.
The video game industry has a well-deserved reputation for screwing up licenses they acquire. They do on occasion get it right. In 2005, THQ and Volition released The Punisher. As a somewhat jaded fan after two crappy Punisher movies and a few forgettable games back on the NES and Genesis, I didn't have high hopes for this newest one. Right off the bat, I was relieved to know that the game had nothing to do with the movie that had come out the previous year. So I fire up the Xbox and find myself in a third-person perspective orgy of violence. Turns out the folks behind this game seem to have actually read the comic a time or two. As a result, this game is what a licensed game should be, a quality experience for fans of the source material. Let me fill you in case you're a little fuzzy on the Punisher. Frank Castle was a Vietnam vet who after the war became a special forces instructor and family man. Frank's happy life comes crashing down when his wife and children are murdered by mobsters for witnessing a hit. When the legal system allows the mobsters to walk, Frank takes matters into his own hands and becomes the Punisher, vowing to rid the streets of violent criminals. But given the fact that the so-called law failed him, he takes no prisoners and has killed hundreds of drug dealers, rapists, child murderers, and mafia members. Spider-Man and Batman involve the police, but not our man Frank. And in this game, he doesn't just kill the bad guys, he freaking annihilates them. The Punisher on Xbox is filled with over-the-top, comic book-style violence, which is perfect. There are special execution spots throughout each level which you use to interrogate and eviscerate any poor saps who try to stop you. Some of these are very creative, like running a drill press through a guy's head or dangling a dude headfirst over a shark tank. The storyline in the game sticks fairly close to the comics, especially writer Garth Ennis' version of the Punisher. As a Punisher fan, I gotta tell you, this game really nails the shady underworld vibe of the comics that it's based on. What would a good comic book be without a few cameos? And we get Black Widow, Nick Fury, and Iron Man making an appearance, as well as traditional Punisher villains such as Kingpin, Bushwhacker, and Jigsaw. Matt Murdock, that's Daredevil if you didn't know, even shows up at one point as the Punisher's attorney. No Spider-Man though, which sucks, because that's the first comic that the Punisher ever appeared in. Getting into the technical aspects of the game, the graphics are dark and gritty, even if they are a tad simple. Audio-wise, the music and sound effects are about what you'd expect, but nothing spectacular. However, the voice acting is pretty good. Even though the game has no relation to the 2004 film, Thomas Jane does the voice acting for Frank Castle, and even though I hated him in the movie, he does a great job here. The dialogue is kinda cheesy at times, but come on, it's a comic book game. The enemy character designs are kind of dull and they repeat too often. You may feel like you're killing the same few guys over and over and over. But there are a ton of levels that help keep things fresh. They did a great job recreating a fight between Frank and this huge Russian dude that was taken straight out of the comic book. The jungle level is also kick-ass. The controls are right on, very easy to pick up and play. The Punisher can hold weapons in both hands and the triggers on the controller serve to fire the left and right weapons respectively. The X button lets you perform a quick kill when you're close to a baddie. These are highly gruesome and highly entertaining, plus there's a ton of different ones depending on what you've got equipped. Pressing the Y button sends Frank into his rage mode. The more enemies you kill, the more you build up your rage meter, and once he's in his rage mode, he's invincible and he starts tearing people apart with knives. Yeah, it's as fun as it sounds. They give you an adjustable difficulty that's balanced pretty well, but the game still feels a tad on the easy side. There's upgrades and unlockables that you earn by scoring high in each mission. That's right, there's a score. A score for punishing. Isn't that neat?
I don't know what I went, I swear.
Alright, obviously I'm inclined to like this game because of its subject matter, but even so, I wasn't expecting it to be as good a game as it turned out to be. Even if you've never read a Punisher comic, it's a pretty good pick-up-and-play action title. There's also a PS2 version available if you don't have the Xbox. Either version should only run you about $5 or $10, at least here in the United States. So it's a pretty cheap game at that too, so I gotta say it's a keeper. Now, I gotta go scrub a bunch of makeup off my face before I go to work tomorrow. If they're lucky.
Themselves to fighting crime.
Today, we're looking at Legends of the Superheroes. Now, how cool would it be to get all of your favorite comic book heroes into one singular live-action project? Nah, I'm not talking about the new Avengers movie. In 1979, the heroes and villains from the DC Universe got together in a two-part televised event hosted by Ed McMahon. Hey, celebrity roasts were all the rage back then, so why not capitalize on it? How could it possibly go wrong? Well, it did. At the age of 9, I thought this was the best thing ever. It wasn't until 15 years after the fact, I saw it as a festering, nightmarish load of crap. It was canned, unfunny, terribly acted, produced, written, directed, yet I still loved it in spite of itself. And even had a bootleg copy on VHS and played it until the tape snapped. It's now on DVD, and as embarrassing as it is to watch some of those aging stars fit into those tight costumes after 10 years, like Adam West and Burt Ward as Batman and Robin respectively, it is still worth a nostalgic trip down Amnesia Lane.
As a matter of fact, a few years ago, the NAACP asked you guys to integrate. And I'm sorry, but we don't feel the Green Lantern qualifies as colored people. Hey. Now, I don't want you to think I'm the only black superhero. We got lots of them. Like the Green Lantern over there, he gets his power from a ring, right? We got a hero just like that. We call him Sammy Davis Jr.
Hey folks, this is Matt from Video Masters TV, and we're here at the 2009 Comic Convention, and I'm here at the Ghostbot Studios booth. I'm here with Alan. Hey Alan, how you doing?
Hey Matt, how you doing?
I'm doing great. How was it coming down here to the Comic-Con?
It's always quite a trek to get down here. There's a lot of people and a lot of excitement, but it's great to be here.
Awesome. Is this your first con?
No, it's about my fifth con, but this is the first con that GhostBot's premiering here at a booth.
I see. That's sweet. Tell me a little bit about what's on the screen here, the Little Lost Ghost.
This is one of our brand new ideas, Little Lost Ghost, that we're premiering here at the San Diego Comic-Con. And it's basically an original idea that we wanted to do and have fun with.
Sweet. Yeah, it looks awesome. And the book is rad as well as all the art. You guys just kick ass no matter what you touch. So.
Thank you, Matt. Thank you.
Yeah. All right, Alan, I'll see you later.
Okay, cool. Thanks. See you guys later.
All right. Now we're here at a different angle, and I'm with Brad. Hey, bro.
Hey, how you doing?
Pretty good. Wait to talk until I get the mic right.
Okay.
Dumbass. Anything in particular you'd like to say about Little Lost Ghost?
Well, yeah, this is our property, Little Lost Ghost. It's all about Misfit, and she's a ghost looking to find out what happened in her past. It's a big mystery. She doesn't know what happened. Is she a good guy? Is she a bad guy? Right now, we have a storybook and prints and buttons, and we're presenting it all here.
You got a nice booth. I like your posters. Your T-shirts are kick-ass. What do you think? No comment.
Nice. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Anything in particular you'd like to say about your swag you got here?
Well, I wasn't really going to say this earlier, but this is all just kind of a front for a secret operation we have going. That's all I'm going to say about that.
Cool. I like the demo that's looping here and the music and the visuals. It's awesome. I feel like I'm really out in space.
Okay, cool. That's the idea.
Nice. We'll see you later.
Okay.
We're here with Master Illustrator, Mr. Ballesteros. I'm sorry?
I said, what's up?
What's up, man? What are you drawing there?
We're doing some free sketches whenever somebody purchases something at the GhostBot booth. So we're just drawing characters from this world. I'm drawing like this weird combo of chipmunks and machine. I don't know. Just making it up as we go.
Sweet. Is there a name for this world?
Do we have a name for this world? Yeah. Forest Land.
All right. So how fast can you draw that?
Let's see. Probably I'll be done in about a minute. Just kind of do it quick. It's good for the perfectionist side of us, where we try and make everything look perfect. Just trying to bust these out fast, or else we'll be here all day.
I understand. All right. Rocky, thank you so much.
Welcome.
Later.
All right, that concludes this episode of VMTV. Thank you for watching. Be sure to leave a comment below and share this episode with your friends, family, coworkers, ex-girlfriends, inmates, and that neighbor who sifts through your trash every Tuesday. Until the next episode of VMTV comes your way, my name is John, telling you all, as always, take care of yourselves and keep playing. See you next time.
However, once in a good while, there are some that are actually really good. Our entry this month is one of those. It is called Batman. City of Arkham! Like City of Scars! Fuck!
City of Seeds.
City of Seeds. Okay, here we go.
I did not put my seed in her, and I'm of a different species.
She put her seed in him, actually. Okay, ready?